Everybody, a hand for the legendary. X-Men from 1974 to 1991 versus all the X-Men since. I didn't say that. Just by the way. Okay, that pretty much shoots up my prepared comments of the day. Other than the fact that you should go out and buy Nightcrawler, first issue. Sold out its print run of 55K. And went back to press. So we want to try and do something really dramatic and cool with the second issue, the third issue, the fourth issue. Especially since we've been greenlit for a complete year. Yeah. The only downside is now I can pick up stories. But we want to try something remarkably uncharacteristic for the modern sales era. We would like sales to go up. Used to have, oh my gosh. Yes, foolishly, I acquainted this with conventions where they actually had bottles of water. Wow. As opposed to this weird stuff that's made by Pepsi, it's, you know, the bottle or whatever their silly water name is.
In New York, we use just, you know, they call it, I don't know, water. Turn on the tap, it comes out of the water, you know?
Oh God, I'm trying to adjust.
Thank you. Purified drinking water, as opposed to what? Impure drinking water? Purified drinking water?
So, how about that giant Japanese monster? Who's seen it? Okay, how was it? Which seems to be roughly the size of Kilimanjaro. if not Everest itself. He's on steroids. He's in the trailer. Wow. A nice secret. And forgive me, those of you who've been by my table and heard this joke before. There's this lovely scene in the trailer where, oh, what's his face? From Breaking Bad. Brian Cranston goes running down the hall, because of course his wife is trapped behind the door and Fukushima is going, etc., etc., etc. He's really doing it. Oh my god, I've seen the X-ray, we're gonna get creamed! That's what I like. You know, mutants, giant Japanese monster, duke it out, who's gonna win? I figured, you know. Because Spider-Man seems to have shuffled off the court. Yeah, you know, and fortunately it's gonna be 2 months until we have to worry about Guardians of the Galaxy. Another one. You know, Jerry may have created it, but I jumped in. Anyone? I got fired. Okay, enough of this. I'm babbling. That's because I'm, you know, trying to get the water to wash it. Foolishness out of myself. Does anyone have any questions before I make even more of a fool of myself than I have now? Yes, ladies first.
I'm very honored to be here.
Oh, sure.
The very first X-Men that
sounds
I ever...
Sounds like I'm driving all
Well, the very first X-Men I ever read was... your storyline with Wolverine's marriage.
Oh yeah, that trick never works.
How do you feel seeing that play out on the big screen? Because the Wolverine movies pull from that.
Well, the interesting story was back in the day. I got a call. From Darren Aronofsky, not him, but from his people. They were just setting up their shop in Brooklyn, and they asked me to come down and read Chris McQuarrie's first screenplay for Wolverine. And I thought, wow.
Wolverine?
No, the second one.
Okay.
The Wolverine. There is the X-Men Legends Wolverine, which is like 43 minutes of and about 20 minutes of not so bad with, let's face it, Hugh Jackman, absolutely cool, Lev Schreiber, hey, I never knew Logan was Jewish, and I never knew that, you know, Lev Schreiber was the older brother. Which I suppose makes more sense than my concept, which would have made him dad, but that would be weird. X-Men Wolverine Legends was forced on by Fox. Because the feeling was the general film audience, i.e. not you guys, no offense, would not understand who he is, or what he is, or why he is.
He needed an origin.
Yes. Interesting introduction. My feeling was, dude, it's Hugh Jackman, who cares? It's like, he walks out on screen, you go, okay, that's Wolverine, no problem. And the rest is irrelevant. But what do I know? I'm not only a civilian, i.e. I don't make movies, I live on the East Coast, which is worse. Yes, you guys are in the middle. You have no idea how thick the prejudice is. It's like, in a world of Japanese cars, you're trying to make a case for non-Japanese cars. Well, that joke kind of died. anyway,
three or four of my signature lines to him, which made me an impossibly annoying person to take to the movie. Where the screenplay, I'm like, yes! And my wife was giving me elbows in the mid, in the kidneys because I won't shut up, but I'm sorry. But Hugh Jack was like, I'm the best there is at what I do. Whatever, this is very nice.
Yes!
And what do we mean by that? Les Miserables! Even then I do. But, so they wanted to get an origin story out there.
Now you know why I'm paid by the word. Never say in one sentence what you can say in a volume.
Or, as George R. R. Martin does, five volumes. So I get a call from Darren Aronofsky's people. They ask me to read the Wolverine script, and it's really cool. You know, I'm sitting in his offices. It's the middle of the winter. It's New York. It's, you know, about as primal as you can get. In other words, think of the last five episodes of Elementary, What's-His-Face series, James Spader's series,
Blacklist,
of whatever iteration of Law and Order is still in print. And I'll be enough, The Good Wife, which, even though it's set in Chicago, is filmed in Brooklyn! Oh yeah, and Blue Bloods and Wild Bloods. Lots of good stuff being filmed in Brooklyn. Sorry. Are you guys filming Superman out here?
Yes.
Three films in one. Holy cow. That'll be impressive. But anyway, Macquarie's screenplay was really good. It was a first draft, but it was really good. And we'll get back to you after the Oscars. Cool. I thought, wow, this is it. We're going to have fun. They're going to make the movie. I'm going to give notes. I'm going to be involved. I'll finally get a chance to help. And then Lex Swan won Oscars. And Alec Workman won Oscars. And Darren Aronofsky looked at it and said, Black Swan, which only cost $10 million, earned $120 million. Hi, Fox.
Yes.
This is Darren.
Yes.
I'm taking a vacation, dude. I'm sorry, I can't do your movie. Sorry. Bye. Fox, of course, does not respond well when people do that. Case in point, X-Men 3. And so they quickly got together, and Hugh and the director he worked with got together, and they rewrote the screenplay. And made it much, I guess, more acceptable to the studio and to what they thought would be the general audience, and not any more a straight adaptation of Frank's and my graphic novel, which was kind of frustrating because this is something the producer and I, and we've been working towards for 15 years. But that's Hollywood. And now we're kind of figuring out to see what happens next. And my curiosity will be, in the theater next week and see if Brian got it right, using the title. There used to be robots in it. It's very 70s. I don't know what the TARDIS is doing in the White House, but that's a totally different story. And my basic feeling is, that is probably the richest, most talented, most box office holy cows cast I have seen. I mean, you could take any two members of that cast and build an award-winning, successful movie out of it.
And they have.
What?
And they have.
And they have. And, you know, leaving aside the fact that Ian McKellen and Patrick Stewart have become best friends and Broadway stars, doing God knows how Samuel Beckett for 6 months to packed houses. You know, I can't wait. I mean, just for nothing else than to see it as an acting class. I think it's way cool. But we'll know in a week. There was a, you know, the problem is with superhero movies, the hope is you're going to get the Avengers, but sometimes the reality is you get Spidey 2.2. Well, if you just say Spidey 2, everyone gets confused. Wait, do you mean this Spidey, or do you mean the last Spidey with Alfred Molina? Because that was really good, you know? Yes, it was really good, but that was because it was directed by Sam Raimi, who was really good. But Sam foolishly had this attitude with Disney, which is, how about for the third movie we have less characters? And Sony was like, no! We want more characters! Three movies in the third, three characters in the third, four in the fourth, five in the fifth. Well, oddly enough, this is the fifth movie, and what do we have? The Sinister Six. Yes, six characters, because they can't count. And Harry Osborn back from the dead. You look like a thing like you did in the last movie, dude. Shot. I'm making fun of Spidey because I can't. And because the X-Men movie hasn't come out yet. Okay, sorry, next question. Yes.
Going through a lot of your work, especially with X-Men, it's
going what?
Going through a lot of your like written work. Sorry.
You think, what a blabbermouth.
I know, right?
Oh, he agrees with
me. Oh, my. This is always telling me, but my point. Going through a lot of your written work, you know, X-Men especially,
yeah.
I notice that you have these two kind of, some of the thing contradictory thing, where you have a huge interest in like this kind of military technology thing. You know, you cite all of these things, you know, with what you named Lockheed and Sikorsky and everything. And you also have this investment in, you know, female camaraderie, you know, even to the point of Mystique and Destiny and who was supposed to be Nightcrawler's parents and all that. I'm just wondering, like, where that comes from, like, this pairing of, like, something that's considered ultra-ultra-macho and something that's considered almost the antithesis of that.
Well, my mom was RAF. My uncle was RAF. My father was RAF. That's part of it. My mom was 20, and she was helping staff a radar installation on the South Coast. And every morning, the mom from across the way would come over, better known as the Luftwaffe. They'd drop some souvenirs. They do low passes, say, hi, how are you? Stand still, let's shoot you better so we can shoot you properly. They bomb the living daylights out of the radar, and then in the evening they put it back together again and start again in the morning. Let's see, she made sergeant three times and was busted private Ford. Well, because there were Americans in town, and they had highlights, and they had access to food. And my mother was 20, and she wanted to have a good time, so she didn't see why she had to behave or play by the rules, which is a typical fighter pilot attitude, which is why she became a pilot. So that's probably where this all started. You know, my best friend my wife and I, you know, woke up one morning listening to NPR, and I hear Scott Simon reporting from Sarajevo. This is back in the 90s. And suddenly I hear my best friend's voice say, "Scott!" And you hear these weird sound effects in the background. I'm thinking, what was that? And she said, "Scott! Scott, will you duck your head? They're shooting at us!" And I thought, oh, those are bullets. Holy. Oh my goodness. No, I didn't say, oh my goodness. My best friend is being shot at by people who are trying to kill him. Well, they missed, fortunately, because NPR wouldn't broadcast it quite that casually anyways. But, you know, I have another friend who's got more awards than I care to think about. And that's starting with the Pulitzer and working down to the Humboldt, and she's been nominated for four additional Pulitzers. And you don't want to know. And on her best bud, like, you know, call list, these are people who call her regularly and she calls them regularly, are two ex-presidents and an ex-vice president. So, and for, you know, she has been known to, on a whim, go into Central Africa hunting down Ebola virus. These are not wallflower people. So when I create characters for the X-Men, for anywhere, but for the X-Men, I try to draw from the people I know in life. I happen to know some frighteningly ballsy people. A dear friend of mine, an old woman, went for a drive one day in north, sort of like northeast Saudi Arabia. And the next thing he knew, he was grabbed by the Iraqis and spent about 2 weeks in detention in central Iraq, in Baghdad, you know, because he crossed over the border. And, you know, one of the perils of being chief foreign correspondent for a major radio network. You know, it's, when you know people who do that, who are legitimate in the holy crap, they do stuff that's real. I guess my attempt is to try and steal as much of that as I can and imbue the X-Men or whomever I'm writing with a piece of it so that that can come through to you guys as the readers and make them more exciting, more enticing, more daunting, more plausible. Fantastic as they seem, than they might otherwise be. And ideally, if I do it right, it will leave you desperate to come back and see what the hell happens next. Because in its cruelest, most primal level, everything we write as serial adventure producers, as X-Men writers, as Nightcrawler writers, is I want you to love this issue. I want you to come back next issue. I want to be picked up for a 1 year run. I would like the 1 year run to turn into a 5 year run, or a 10 year run, or a 20 year run. The way to do that is to do good stories. The way to do good stories is to find characters and events that keep you on the edge of your seat, worried that I'm going to do something awful to the character, and then come up with a brilliant way of getting the character out of it. So that you're thinking, wow, that character is really brilliant. And then of course we put them in even worse. Oh, in an even worse scenario next year. We are such sadists.
And theoretically, you know, the ultimate bottom line is we keep trying until we get it right. And at least the first time around, back in the 90s, we did. And we were going great guns. And so I'm figuring, okay, it's been a while since then. Maybe everyone's forgotten. We can try it again and catch them all by surprise. At least that's the hope. We are a venal cowardly lot. And ruthless in our intent to get you hooked on the water. Yeah.
Do you have a plan to explain Betsy's racial change? Or did that? Oh, there's one thing they did sort of look at in that movie.
I don't know. What did you?
Somewhat.
Yeah, what about?
So,
what have they done?
When she came back from the.
Are you talking about the original one? When Jim had this real weird idea, and we thought, okay, that's what the heck, we'll do it for the miniseries, the three issues he was doing it. And then of course you drew her looking so beautiful that it was like, oh screw it, let's go with this and see what happens. No, that was my idea. I mean Jim did it, you know. We thought it would be.
It wasn't meant to last.
Well, many things aren't meant to last until you actually see them, and then it's like, holy cow. I mean, apparently Paul Smith did not mean the Mohawk as a serious fashion statement for Aurora. He got blindsided by me and Weezy, kind of like, whoa, no one will ever see this coming. They are going to hate our guts. Yeah. They're going to react just like Kitty does. We went for it. See, never give a good writer and a good editor an opportunity to think, wow, I didn't see that one coming. Because if we don't see it coming, you're never going to see it coming, and that means we're going to do it. Because that'll get you interested to see, A, can we really be that dumb? B, we are now so pissed that we're going to read this book until we find out how you did it. Then we're going to yell at you a lot, and then we're going to keep protesting until you fix it, or we love it. But either way, we've got more readers, and you know that's our vicious, mean, nasty. You know, it's like doing atonal music. You hate it until you like it, or not. Yeah. Like your hair. I only speak from a position of absolute envy.
I got another set just like
it. Oh, I so hate that. Yes.
Is there a character that you wish you could have done more with? Do you wish?
Is there a character you think I should have done more with?
No.
Yes. All. Because, you know, you keep writing until their lives are done, and then, you know, you move on. And in my case, I've left the X-Men as a series writer a half dozen times, and each time I figure, well, that's it, I'm done. And I come back and it's like, no, I'm not. You know, Nightcrawler to me, I've known him now for, God help me, 35 years. And I'm still, you know, there are still things I'd like to learn about. You know, it's perhaps a bit more frustrating now than it used to be because the editors these days seem to have minds of their own, which is always annoying. But you get used to it, you work around it. And I figure, as always, if I'm still interested, if I have questions at the end of a story, if I want to see what happens next, then I'm egotistical enough to hope that that will translate through to you guys and you'll feel the same way, or more. and we'll keep coming back. Because that's, forgive me for sounding so crass, that's the bottom line. We can have the best ideas, the best stories, the best conflicts, the best resolutions imaginable. But if none of you care about the story, if none of you are interested enough to read the story, it's all for naught. And when you're doing a solo series like Nightcrawler, I gotta get your attention amidst all of the crossovers that are going on around it, and all of the argle-bargle, and oh my God, Logan, you know, hi, I'm just back from the dead. And how does my best friend celebrate it? I mean, if I were Nightcrawler, I'd be a little bit peeved. But, you know, we'll see. There, I presume, you know, it does leave the option open for stories and for character development. And I wouldn't want to get in his way for a couple of months after that. But then again, you know, Kurt's attitude might be, oh, hell, I'm just going to rescue him. I mean, you know, it's, think of it. I mean, he was a postulant priest, and now he knows as a fact, heaven is real. That can do weird stuff to your faith. It's like, it's not imagination anymore, it's real. And then how do you tell everybody you know? You have to behave yourself, Kitty. Why? Because heaven is real. Only if you die.
I'm playing on that. What do you think about the recent announcement of the Death of Wolverine series that's coming out?
They're killing the series or killing
they're killing the character?
Yeah, I've been there, done that. I did it before the series even started. I think it depends on the quality of the story. Hopefully it'll be a lot better than the origin. But, you know, Bill Jennis and I had impassioned words about that. Oh, Christ, 15 years ago. Sorry. It's not my call, not what I would have done, not my call, but, you know, we'll see what happens. If it's an eloquent story and it convinces you guys that it works, we'll see. If a month later Hugh Jackman announces that they're doing Wolverine 3, that'll be an interesting challenge for everybody, because do you want to leave the print medium empty when there's a Wolverine movie, you know, out in 18 months? Or do you bring it back? I don't know. We'll just have to wait and see. Or as the old Mel Brooks song says, hope for the best, expect the worst. Could be Tolstoy or Fanny Hurst. So, you know, we'll just, how the hell do you get Fanny Hurst into an 18th century Russian film?
Can you talk a little bit about the ending of Dark Phoenix? How it came across?
She died. She wasn't supposed to get better. No, what happened, I mean the original conflict, the primal conflict,
I am on conflict,
was that we turned in the plot and the editor, okay, greenlit the plot, and what was going to happen was the Shi'ar catch up with them, there's a big fight, they take Jean on to the Shi'ar starship, they
subject her to the whoopee whoopee ray. Jean screams horribly, and Scott reaches out to her and pulls her back in, and when all is said and done, she's Jean Grey. All of the power has been leached out of her. She's a normal girl with roughly, at this point, half a brain, so. Yes, Scott, your girlfriend is no longer able to end civilization as we know it in the Omniverse, and she's dumb as a fruitcake. Scott's happy as clam. Yeah, that we don't want to go there. Though Emma would probably have a good time with that one. Anyway. And then Jim Shooter, as editor-in-chief, read the issue and felt there was one little itty-bitty problem. You know, you commit planetary genocide and kill 5 billion sentient people, including kids, and all that happens is you get a slap on the wrist. Because let's face it, this is comic books, and no one's gonna let the redhead stay without her powers for more than like 6 months. You know, it's gonna start leeching back. She's gonna start sensing things, and before you know it, Magneto will be looking at his little chess set at the end of X3 and he'll and you know he's back. Or Charlie turns into somebody completely different on the far side of the world and says, it's me, Chop. Because in 3 films, he's coming back looking just like he always did. Yes? There are many things we don't know about. Do you think I would tell you everything? Why, Charlie, you're using a comic book rationale to explain why you're still in the movies. Jim... He felt that was a non-starter. And he had a point. You know, you can't. I mean, I could make all sorts of really, really inappropriate Nazi references, but the gist of it is, you know, you can't commit total genocide and get away with it. So she had to be punished. So what are we going to do? And basically, we were both tired of the story. Had to come to an end. And if we just threw her in cosmic prison, the next 10 years of the X-Men would be, we're going to rescue Jean. No, we're not. Yes, we are. No, we're not. Yes, we are. Or we rescue Jean and let's all catch Jean and throw her back. It'll just turn into a never-ending, chasing. I think it'll leave that to the Avengers. I said, screw it, let's come around. So we did. And it turned out to be the right decision. Because the whole point of it was to say, Jean is dead, and we're going to try something daring and unheard of in comics. We're going to leave her dead. We're not going to bring her back. Dead is dead. She's going to the same place that John Proudstar went, and he hasn't come back, and she's not going to come back, and that's it. And we got away with it for about 4 years. that's why when John and company proposed X Factor, when I finally got rational again, I went to Jim and I gave him a pitch. And I said, what we need to do here, X Factor is a great concept. Fine. Resurrecting Jean is dumbass. Aside from the fact you're saying, fuck you, pardon me, to all of the fans who bonded with Jean's death, who were moved by Jean's death, who were affected by Jean's death, we're making the stories a lie, a total lie, and we can never get away with it again. We're saying that the death, or the threat of death in the Marvel Universe is just, it's a cheap, dramatic trope.
That is.
That's not. This is that. But, and having Scott dump his wife and his newborn child to go back to the original
once-dead girlfriend probably doesn't paint him in the, how shall we put it, most admirable, heroic, human, and decent light. You know, so we destroy the guts of the story arc that is one of the key foundations of X-Men. Oh yes, and we destroy one of the seminal characters in the book. Irrevocably. Because while people will forgive many things, you can't walk out on your wife and baby and get away with it. This is just, I mean, is it any wonder he spent the next 20 years like stooping Emma? Well, no, because they're of a piece. He's a creep, and she bonds with creeps. So, my point was, leave the Scott status quo as it is. He's married to Madeline. Madeline is not Jean. He has a wife and son. He is a responsible parent. He is off the board romantically. He's spoken for.
What about Lynn Stella?
Wait. Jean has
Luke. Like Luke, you have a sister.
She has her older sister, Rachel, who has superpowers. What are her mutant powers? She detects mutants. Well, let's see, if I'm doing a team called X-Factor, and my job is to, what's the word? Detect mutants. Wow. A character who could actually do that would be useful? Yes, I said. And more importantly, she's unattached. She's a gray. She's unattached. She's beautiful. She now puts Bobby and Hank and Warren in play. The book can have Scott and Madeline off to one side and can be about the three other guys who, let's face it, the minute you bring back Scott and Jean as the core romantic relationship, Bobby, Hank, and Warren become irrelevant again. What do you want to create? The bad things about the X-Men as well as the good stuff? You know, this was my take on it. I suspect John and the company would have just come after me with brickbats. And Jim, he liked the idea, he liked the concept of Sarah as a character, but he committed to X-Factor as it was originally presented. And so he said no. And the rest is history. So, you know, the idea is you have to walk the fine line between what is satisfying to you as a fan, because creators can be fans too. What is satisfying to the audience as adventure stories, and you know. There are only so many times you can bring Bobby Ewing back from the dead before everyone starts saying, you know, Dallas is a weird show. you have to play fair with the audience. You cannot, even when they want something more desperately than dinner, sometimes you have to say no, because if you give it to them, then you're saying all the emotions you felt the first time when the character died or when the character was in peril or when whatever happened, they're nothing. And if I'm a reader and I come across that moment in a book, that's, for me, that's the classic jumping the shark. And once you do it, no offense, for those of you, anyone who remembers Happy Days, when you jump the shark, there's no going back. You know, you're just... So that's where that all came from. Yeah.
It's a multi-part question, but it's all the same set. always changed. Where are your thoughts on the evolution of it? Do you like where it's going? Are there things that you're seeing happening that you're not liking? Are there things that you, back in the 70s, you had no idea of what would happen? Or are things that you've expected to happen that never fulfilled?
Back in the 70s, I thought phones would stay stapled to the wall right along. You know, back in the 70s, I thought I'd be writing books forever on pen and paper in my IBM Selectric. Selectric's a keyboard, you know, that doesn't have a memory. Well, it does have a memory, it's called a human being. You know, being blindsided by the future is a case of, is, that's the reality of the books in reality. I haven't too, but actually, my responsibility to turn around. Does anyone have any thoughts, positive, negative, whatever, about the X-Men? Do you like the way it's going? Do you want it to go differently? Do you hate the way it's going? Why? Anyone want to toss in a comment quickly? Yeah.
Well, I like X-Men Forever, and I want to know where that goes at the end of that, but that's not what it is. Do you have ideas for where you were going to that right
now? Oh, hell yes. I know exactly where I'm going. I'm not going to tell you. Hope springs eternal, I'll tell you. Maybe someday the Democrats will come up with a smart idea. And play it through to the end. It's so frustrating. Yeah.
There's some bad parts, but I think overall I do love the acting of Tom. Maybe the only person in the room that I love very well is his mind.
Is the Phoenix.
Because when the omniverse comes to the end, when the last star goes out, when all is still, someone's got to light the match to start the next iteration all over again. That's the Phoenix. The Phoenix is Gene. To say there's Phoenix, and there's Dark Phoenix, and there's Red Phoenix, and there's Phoenix, Arizona. Yes, off in the distance, down at the bottom of the valley, is this giant structure that, from a distance and as even closer, it's roughly the size of Olympus, whatchamacallit, on Mars. Yeah. And it is the TARDIS. Yeah, they keep each other coming. So, the star's going out, and as it's almost faded out, a light appears in the sky overhead, and it grows brighter and brighter and brighter, it coalesces, and you realize it's a human figure. And it's not only a human figure, it's the red hole. She's finally come back to hook up with her gun. So Kitty's watching. The redhead lands. I should point out that Lucky's on her back. You know, I mean, literally, just tattooed on her back. Because, you know, even dragons have that side. And this way, while she's doing stuff, he's watching her back. So they're watching. Jean and Wolverine embrace. Kitty turns her back because that would be rude to watch that. The star goes out, all is dark, still, quiet. For maybe about 5, 7, 10 seconds. And then the light bursts from where they were. The most incredible, blinding, brilliant, passionate, wonderful, creative, effervescent light you've ever imagined. So intense and so transcendent that it instantly spreads across every fraction of the omniverse. Every dimension is instantly reborn. Every point of creation hits the reboot button. And Kitty looks at Lucky, Lucky looks at Kitty, and she said, shrugs and says, well, here we go again. And that's the end. What is the end? It's a new beginning. And that's as it should be. Because the story never ends. It evolves. It gets better. It gets richer, hopefully. But it never stops. And that's
what one likes to think is that the same holds true for life and reality. Any more questions? Oh.
I just reread one of the early AIDS issues where Xavier has a flashback where he was hanging out for the first time.
Yeah.
And it kind of introduces that whole backstory that character didn't have for the first 20 years of existence. And I really do think that makes him a richer character, but I wonder if you could talk a little bit about your idea of bringing that into the book.
Well, that was cool. I wanted to do a series of stories where you had Jean and Charlie working together when she was in her early teens, and he hadn't figured out to start the X-Men yet. I kind of hinted at it in one of the issues I did with the Cuberts back in 2000. My very short run on X-Men, where she shows Gambit her little hidey hole in the box underneath Venice. And it's this huge cave loaded with the loot of ages. So you realize, oh, Jean's the richest person in the world because she's been looting things forever. it's just the idea has always been to, the adventure is a lot older, deeper, more exciting, more dynamic than you suspect, and it should, if it were me, always catch you by surprise. It should not be anything you expect, and it should not be anything you can categorize as predictable. Obviously, I'm very old school.
Horsemanship, Wolverine versus Nightcrawler.
Nightcrawler. As we demonstrated in the first issue of Nightcrawler. He's too fast, he teleports. Logan can figure, he's at the point where he can anticipate where Nightcrawler will reappear instantly, but Kurt will disappear equally instantly and come in at him from another angle. Nightcrawler is the best there is at what he does. Wolverine has a bit more variety, but Kurt's just really cool. The only thing that would be more cool is what we did in Forever, which is flop him and Rogue. Because, let's face it, she looks so much better with that physiognomy than he does. Sadly. Poor guy. Logan's had enough fun for 30 years. Let Nightcrawler have some. But I think from a swordsmanship hand-to-hand, Kurt's got the edge. Logan's just, he's not quite fluid enough. He's too solid, too condensed. I mean, no, it, like a Wolverine. A Wolverine is a very dangerous animal, but he's not. It's not a. We're not talking ferociously agile. He's not a mongoose. Yeah.
When it comes to the movies, are you hoping for a closer adaptation of the novel, or something that's in the same spirit of it, but maybe with telling a different story? Because there's some movies that try to stay really, really close to the plot, like the Sin City one, but a lot of them...
I would have said Harry Potter. Ask me Friday.
You haven't seen it yet?
No.
They ask
Fox, what's the point? You know, I mean, it's, what was it? The producer wanted to know if I'd like to fly out to LA to participate in a pre-release press conference with the actors in LA. I said, hell yes. She pitched it to Fox and said, no, we don't know the actors. But, you know, the original writer of the source material is not. Not as far as you know, it's like, I hate to say it, my stock response is the only response, which is it's not my $120 million. Million bucks. It's Fox's, and they get to call the shots. I mean, yes, I'd love to be a part of it. But by the same token, there isn't a Marvel screening either. Why? I don't know. But apparently, it's just it's not in the cards. I guess the feeling is that nobody in the Marvel staff or in the Marvel community is interested. But that's, you know.
Only Marvel had a hold of that franchise these days.
Yeah. If only the Supreme Court had its head on screwed on right back in 2000, the whole history of the world would be different. You know, it's like we can wish to learn blue in the face, or you can be like me and rewrite history. But then it falls under fiction. And even when you rewrite history and do X-Men Forever, if it doesn't sell, it doesn't, you know, what's the point? So, you know, you just, the basic response to all of this is you have to take a deep breath, suck up, move on, and try and fix things next time. There's no right or wrong in this. Really, this is the way the world works, and you either have to invent a better world or do your best to position yourself in the world as it exists, that you can affect changes to what you're doing and where you're going within the framework. And you know, the frustrating news is, I didn't get my 10 seconds of adulation. Okay. And hey, Channing Tatum. It'll be fun. What'll that lead to? Who knows? You know, it's you just keep playing. The point is, as long as the game's going, it still goes on. As long as you're in play, you have a shot. And the game's still going on, and I'm still in play, and I'm taking every shot I can get my hands on. Because it's cool. Yeah.
What would you tell to aspiring writers and everything that want to eventually do stuff like what you've done with X-Men and some of the properties that you have? What would you say to them that are coming up in the, you know, the art world and in the writing world? What, you know, what tips would you give them to aspire to be something like what you've gotten?
Lovely. you want to look at how you should view this paradigm? You got me, you got JK. And I'm not being facetious. I spent 20 years writing the X-Men. It was a lot of fun. I built these characters, I built the canon. I laid the foundation for everything that came afterwards. It has made Aviarat very rich. It has made Disney very rich. I'm okay, but I'm not very rich. J.K. Rowling wrote her novel.
sold her novel, sold the second novel, the third novel, the fourth novel, the fifth novel, sold the movie rights, did this. She has all the cool stuff that the X-Men has. Oh, except that she owns it, which makes all the difference. So that's the first question you have to address if you're talking about being creative and wanting to make a career. Do you want to do your stuff, or do you want to do someone else's stuff? If you do someone else's stuff, you can still do brilliant work. You can be a Frank Miller. You can do Dark Knight. You can do Wolverine. 300, though, made, you know, that was Frank, doing Frank. But the Dark Knight is DC. Wolverine is Marvel. Or you can take the risk of hoping that your own creative work, the stuff that you, that's yours, makes the difference, you know, is successful. In which case, it all comes down to you. So that really is the first question that every creator has to address and figure out for themselves. How you want to play this, and where you want to go, and what makes it worth it to you. And unfortunately, there is no global answer. It's different for each person, different for each situation. But, you know, I kind of wish I'd been a little smarter back in the day. But there you go. Yeah?
I was wondering, like, when you were working at Marvel, do you ever, like, have any encounters with Stan Lee? Like, what was that like?
I don't stand for Stan, this wouldn't be, I mean, the convention. So, you know. And he made a damn fine commercial for the Postal Service. If only the movie had been. So, you know, Stan preserves everything he's got and more. And he's dead. Debt that we owe him as fans is almost impossible to repay. And he'll still do autographs, which is cool. Yep.
Did you do autographs for about 8 hours in a row? Photos of that one?
It's the alternative.
I mean,
when you're 60, it's not bad.
Yeah. Right.
You know, it's, you know, that Stan, God bless him. And, you know, keep on trucking, dude. The world, at least from my eye, will be sadder without it. As it was when Jack, you know, when Jack died and when Dave Buffon died. You know, it shouldn't have happened, but that's life, unfortunately. Yeah.
What's your favorite comic book or superhero book that you've been reading right now?
Dan Dare, Scott Conner, and the Swiss Spice. And Heroes the Spark. The British series from a book called, a magazine called. That was my source material. So, you know, go check out Titan Books. But that's what I'm thinking of. That and Biggie Smalls. How the hell went from Horatio Longbow to Biggie Smalls? I have no idea. Okay, just a couple more questions because otherwise I will get finished by now. I'll get people waiting on my table. Yeah. In terms of uncanny, 94 through 279 inclusive. No one left, it's all one story.
Yes.
Including the sideward spin-offs to the Excalibur and New Mutants movie. That's the way I look at it. Life is life. This is their lives. Therefore, it's one story with lots of little interstitial bits. Subdivided, but it's all one story. That's, to me, what makes it cool. Yes?
Once my grandparents have delayed me for so long, and his birthday's next week, so could you give him an early happy birthday, please?
What's his name?
Chris.
Happy birthday, Chris! Oh, that's you?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Okay, 1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday, Chris.
I really like the art on Nightcrawler. Did you get to pick the artist? Did the editors give you a choice? Did they pick
you
up?
I haven't picked an artist in quite a while. No, this is just, they called up and said, we have this series, you're interested in writing it. And I'm under contract, so I said, oh yes. Todd Buck Milk is good. It's a right blend of excitement and humor. I don't know how the hell we get away with all those naked Banffs, but you know, they're cute, but I have a feeling they're very rude. And God help us all with those pieces of shadow on their lower extremities at the last bench. But, you know, I come from the days of the Comics Code Authority, and they view comics in a slightly different way than we do, which is to say, different, you know, everything evolves. The essential thing I hope I'm trying with Nightcrawler is that it's a good read, exciting stories, dramatic conflict, and as much tension and enthusiasm and excitement as there is tragedy and possibly apples. And the opportunity to do a scene of Kurt sitting on his perch on the edge of heaven looking down at the omniverse, mulling about reality. And instead of an angel, a tweety angel coming up and saying, don't you just love heaven so wonderful? Logan comes up and gives him a beer. They sit on the edge of creation and just slug back some good lager and talk about what guys talk about in heaven. And if you believe that, you haven't been paying attention to Wolverine for the last 30 years. So hopefully it'll be a fun scene. You know. Or just fall flat on his face, but visually it looks great. And, you know, we'll see. And the second issue's out, the third issue's on my table. And come take a look. Thank you very much for being so good.